특강으로 들어가도록 하겠습니다. 입문 특강은 저희가 30분을 예정을 하고 있는데요. 입문 특강의 주제는 미디어 구하기, 지속가능한 미디어 모델을 찾아서입니다. 연사분은 줄리아 카제, 프랑스 파리 정치대학교 경제학 교수님께서 입문 특강에 나서 주시겠습니다. 줄리아 카제 교수님은 경제정책연구원에서 경제사, 공공경제학과 산업조직을 연구하고 계십니다. 또 미디어 경제를 주제로 집필해서 11개 언어로 번역된 저서 미디어 구하기 자본주의, 클라우드 펀딩, 그리고 민주주의가 큰 화제를 모은 바 있는데요. 네, 이제 줄리아 카제 교수님의 강연을 큰 박수로 시작해 보도록 하겠습니다. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you can join me in welcoming Dr. Julia Caze to the stage for her talk.
Hello, thank you very much for inviting me. I have to say that this is particularly important for me to be here in Korea and to be invited by this media company on Kyorie, given the specific form and the specific ownership form of this company. You will see that in my work and in my book, Saving the Media, I have defended for years the idea of having a media group that is owned by its own employees. And it's particular by its journalists in order to protect press freedom and in order to protect media independence. And this is this idea that is defended by Ancurie, and I think this is very nice to see that this kind of things can happen with successful media company. I know that this broad Asia Future Forum is devoted to equality, and today I'm going to talk to you about the media. But if you think about the discussion we just had, all the discussion was about having an informed citizenry that is going to push and to defend the idea of reducing inequality all over the world. And we talk about economic democracy, but in order to attain economic democracy, what we need is to have political democracy to begin with. And we won't have political democracy in the world absent media, absent high-quality information, and absent press freedom. The bad news from this point of view is if you look at the state of the media all around the world, the media industry is in crisis. The media industry is in crisis, and this is linked in part to the growing role played by the internet. What we observe everywhere, including in South Korea, is a collapse in the number of journalists, both a collapse in the total number of journalists at the country level, but a collapse in the average size of your newsroom. And the big issue, in fact, with the internet is to which extent does news still have any commercial value? What I'm going to claim is for sure news have a value that is very high. This is a social value. They have a key value because without news, we cannot have democracy. But it may well be that news no longer have any commercial value. And then, if it is the case, we need to think about new forms of producing the news, which is what I did in my book, Saving the Media, and I'm going to try to present you today the main arguments and ideas I defend in these books and in other work I have also done in French. So the first question I'm going to tackle today is about the business model of the media, and in particular, to which extent foundations and philanthropy can be seen as the future of the news media. Then we will turn to this issue as quality news as a public good, and I will conclude with a proposal that is the non-profit media organization. What is kind of striking is that if you look all around the world, we see a growing role of private funders in the provision of public goods as government retrenches. We saw before that one of the reasons why there is an increase everywhere in inequality is because we have lower tax, and in particular, we have like lower tax progressivity, and a lot of very rich people, they claim that they really don't need to pay tax, because they are going to use their money themselves to provide public goods. And this is something that we see for a lot of public goods, including for the media industry. I'm not going to go like through all these different examples, but basically, you know, more than $2 billion have been spent in recent years in the US just to fund media-related projects. And if you take one of the most well-known investigative journalism websites, ProPublica, it was just funded entirely particularly through philanthropy. So basically, philanthropy is becoming a very large part of the revenue streams of a growing number of news companies. And the argument I am going to defend here is the following. Why do we need philanthropy? In fact, we need philanthropy because news is a public good. Information is a public good. The basic definition of a public good is that it cannot be provided by the market. If information is provided only by the market, it means that what you want to increase, what you want to maximize, is your profitability. And if, as a media industry, you want to maximize your profitability, what you are going to do is to decrease the size of the newsroom. You are going to decrease the cost. But as a media willing to provide the public good, what you want to maximize is the quality of information. And this is why we need to think about alternative forms of providing news. Philanthropy is a way to think about that. The big issue of philanthropy, the way we know it today in the majority of the country, including in the US, is that very often it's about one or two very rich people providing the kind of media they want to provide, providing the kind of public goods they want to provide. And what I am going to argue is that, in fact, we need a different form of philanthropy, which is crowdfunding. We don't need two or three billionaires to fund the media industry. We need the citizens to fund the media industry. We need the journalists to fund the media industry, which also implies that we need both the citizens and the journalists to own their media. Why is it the case? Because we need informed citizens for a well-working democracy. It's really something that was striking to me when I realized that in Korea, on Korea, group was founded just after the end of the dictatorship and at the beginning of the democracy. Like, first step toward the democracy, you need a new media group, and you need a new media group that is owned by its journalists. Why do we need to think about the media industry when we think about democracy? Because very often, people define democracy as one person, one vote. I think this is an incomplete definition. And the good way to define democracy is as one informed person, one vote. If citizens are not informed, either their vote is completely random, so it's a little bit as if they were not turning out, or their vote is captured. Look at what happened in the US 2 years ago. Like, we keep thinking and talking about the role played by fake news during Donald Trump election. This is about information. When we think about the Brexit, we keep talking about the role played by fake news in the Brexit. And this is about information. And look at what happens 2 days ago on Sunday in Brazil with the election of Bolsonaro. We know now that, like, fake news have played a role. Like, big companies, they were keeping sending messages through WhatsApp with false information sent to citizens to afraid the citizens against the Labour Party in Brazil. And this has played a role in the election of Bolsonaro. And this is why when we talk about democracy, we really need to talk about providing high-quality information, free information, and biased information to the very large majority of the citizens. I'm not going to go like too far into this, you know, but there is a huge literature. And now we know very well that first, when people are informed, they do vote more. When people are informed, governments are more accountable, so there is less corruption, there is a better provision of public good. And when people are less informed, if you have a decrease in the amount of information given to the people, if you have a decrease in the quality of information, then people, they do vote less. What is kind of very surprising is that if you look at what is happening nowadays with the internet, you can think a priori that we will be more informed. You know, you open your computer, you go online, you are going to find a lot of information just available on the internet for free. So from a certain point of view, there is more information available today than in the past. But at the same time, if you look at what is happening in terms of trend, people are voting more or less today than they were in the past. Why is it so? This is what I am trying to explain to you today. But before giving you explanation, let me just insist on this piece of evidence. If you look at the last US election in 2016, It has been well shown that Donald Trump outperformed in the counties with the lowest numbers of new subscribers. So where people were less informed, they voted more for Trump, and where people were more informed at the end of the day, they voted more for Hillary Clinton. And so the big question is, why does the impact of traditional news outlets differ from the one of digital-only media? In a sense, first part of the answer is linked to the way we consume news, and the second part of the answer is linked to the way we produce news. What about the way we consume news? That's true that there is more news available today than there were in the past. But there is more of a lot of other things available today than in the past. And basically, when you go on the internet, or just think about the fact that you watch TV, like 40 years ago, when you were going to watch TV, there were 4 or 5 TV channels, okay? And basically, you know, like from time to time, you had to watch news. There were like 13 minutes of news on your TV channels, and you did not have a lot of choice. What about today? Today you watch TV, and what are you going to find on TV? 50, 100, from time to time, 200 different TV channels. And if you want to, you can decide to select yourself entirely out of news. You spend time on TV, but you never watch any news, just entertainment, like films. You spend time on the internet, but you never read any news. So in a sense, you know, like the internet has increased the media choice. We have more choice today than we had in the past, which means that for people that really do like to consume information, we can consume much more information and better information. But for people that want to select themselves out of news, they can just spend like weeks and months without consuming any news. This is on the side of consumption. But what is key is to look also at how news are produced. Okay, the first thing I was telling you is that the total number of journalists is collapsing everywhere in the world. Let me just show you a figure to begin with that is about France and the US since the 1980s. What we see, and this is even more striking, this is a green line for the US and for France, is that there is this long-term decrease, in particular in the US, in the number of journalists as a share of the total population. What is striking is that in the US, this began in the mid-1980s. So that's not completely news. We have this impression that the internet is like kind of killing journalism, but this is not just linked to the internet. It became way before. Then you have an increase in the collapse with the internet, and that also appears in France, but this is not specific to the internet. In fact, the first factor that explains the collapse in the size of the newsroom is competition, and competition coming in particular from television. Okay. While we see this decrease in the number of journalists in the 1970s, 1980s, is because newspapers at the time, they were suffering from the introduction of television. With the introduction of television, in fact, we find exactly the same thing that what is happening with the internet. And I think we can draw a lot of lessons for what happened at the time of the introduction of television. First thing that happened with the introduction of television, a lot of people, they just stopped subscribing to newspapers. They could watch TV for free. And the second thing that happened with the introduction of television is that there were a collapse in advertising revenues for newspapers. Because obviously, if you are a firm and you want to advertise, it's much more efficient to advertise on TV, and it's much more efficient today to advertise online than to advertise in newspaper. So you have a decrease in revenues from sales, and you have a decrease in revenues from advertising. This is something that I have documented both in the case of France with colleagues and also in the case of the US, and that I just want to summarize in one picture, which is this one. If you look at this picture, what do you have? For the US in blue, you have the newspapers' advertising revenues, and in red, you have the number of daily newspaper journalists. And what you find is that there is an almost perfect correlation between the number of journalists and the advertising revenues. What does it mean? It means that when we add increased competition, both from television and now from the internet, the way newspapers reacted was by cutting the size of their newsroom. The bad news, in a sense, if we don't find alternative model, the bad news is advertising revenues are not going to increase back. And so the threat is to see a continuing collapse in the number of journalists. Now, what I want to say when you see this graph is the following. There is no mathematical formula that is linking the number of journalists and advertising revenues. This is a matter of choice from the point of view of the media owners. In particular, when you see in the mid-1990s, in the US, the collapse in the number of journalists, all the media outlets that were like decreasing the size of their newsroom, they were still making a lot of profits. So the reason why they decided to fire journalists was to maintain their profitability at a very high level. They could have decided to react another way. Say, okay, we have less revenues from advertising revenues, but what we care about is to provide high quality information. So we are going to lose some money. We will still make profit, but our total revenues are going to decline, but we are going to maintain the size of the newsroom to its current level. That you will never have this kind of reaction if the media are just owned by the market. But if you have non-profit media or media outlets that are owned by their employees, then we can have different ways to react to this kind of collapse in advertising revenues. The second big threat to the future of the media I want to highlight is the role played by the internet. Let me just remind you about a world that seemed very, very far to us, a world with only newspapers and without the internet. At the time when a journalist was breaking out a scoop, okay, like a news story, the media outlet was able to monetize the story for at least 24 hours. Basically, you broke out a news story, you will be the only one having the news story in your newspaper for 24 hours. And the other newspapers, they have to wait to publish their own newspapers on the following day. Now, what is happening with the internet? You are going to break out a news story, and then within a couple of minutes, you will find the exact same news stories everywhere. The cost is still the same, or the cost is even like higher from time to time, from the news producer point of view. Okay, if you want to do investigative journalism, you need to pay for that, and this is super costly. But the benefit is very different. Because before the internet, you had some benefits for at least one day, and now you have some benefits for 1 minute, which means that you have no longer any benefits. So why are you going to produce high-quality news, and in particular, why are you going to do some investigative journalism if it comes at a cost without any benefits? While you could choose, and a lot of media outlets are doing that, a very different business model in which you just copy-paste what others are doing. And this is something, you know, I am telling you, like, news propagate very, very quickly. This is something that I documented with two computer scientists, Nicolas Hervé and Marie-Louise Jou. What we have done is that we have studied one entire year of content of the French news media. So basically, we have looked after everything that was published during an entire year by all the French news media. We have 2.5 million documents, and what we look at is the different news stories that happened and the way information propagates. And what we document in this work is the following. First of all, a quarter of the news stories are reproduced online in less than 4 minutes. And second, in a sense, journalists are not superheroes. Okay? So they are not able, you know, to produce an entire article in less than 4 minutes. If we see this super high speed of news propagation, it's just because journalists copy-paste content produced by others. And at the end of the day, if you look at the originality of the content that is produced online, we find that only one-third of the content is original, and two-thirds of what you find online is just copy and paste. And think about what I told you at the very beginning. With the internet, we have the impression that there is more information available. That's true. There is information everywhere. But it does not mean that there is more original information available. In fact, there is more information, but very often we spend our time reading the same news. And very often, in fact, we spend our time reading the same news with the exact same wording. Okay? Because this is the same information, just copy and paste, from the same sources. Let me just jump to the solution. Because as Richard or Kate or Thomas, I tend to be an optimistic. Okay, so the general picture here may sound a little bit dramatic, but in fact, there are a number of solutions. The solution I defined in my book is what I called the non-profit media organization. What is a non-profit media organization? This is a new model that is intermediate in status between public companies and non-profit foundations. And in fact, this is an hybrid model that was inspired in part by the model of the great international universities, which combine both commercial and non-commercial activities. And you will see that there is a little bit more than that in the non-profit media organization, because one goal is to secure the financing of the media, and the second goal is to limit the decision-making power of the outside shareholders. So what is a non-profit media organization? To begin with, this is a non-profit company. Okay? So in this case, if you're a non-profit company, your goal is not to maximize profit, but it will be to maximize the quality of information. What does it mean? It doesn't mean that you cannot have any commercial activities or make any profit, but you need to reinvest all the profit back into the organization. The second important thing is that the shareholders are not allowed to withdraw their capital. And by freezing the capital of the organization, in a sense, you guarantee the independence of the journalist. Okay? Because you cannot have any shareholder that is going to threaten the journalist by saying, if I am not happy with the coverage, you know, I am going to sell your company, I'm going to sell my share. You are not allowed to do so. Okay? Once you give money to a non-profit company, you cannot withdraw your capital. And the third important point is that the contributions are tax deductible, which is a way for the government to help sustaining the funding of the media. The non-profit media organization is a non-profit company, but at the same time, as in a public company, we have a lot of stockholders, each of them with voting rights. And what is key is that these voting rights do not increase proportionally with the shares in the company. Again, we are back to this issue of philanthropy. We want a non-profit model for the media, in which people are willing to give money to fund the media. But we don't want the media to be within the hand of, let me give a couple of names, Jeff Bezos, for example, with one of the largest billionaires in the world, okay? Like the example of increased inequality in the US, warned a newspaper, the Washington Post. This is problematic. And this will be also problematic if Jeff Bezos was owning the Jeff Bezos Media non-profit organization with all the voting shares. So you want crowdfunding, but you want to limit the power of the main shareholders. Okay, so basically, how does it work? Below a certain threshold, let's say that 1% of the capital, the stockholders are allowed to gather to form an association, and this is something that is increasingly developing in a number of places, in which we'll have association of editors, association of readers willing to support their media outlet. Above a certain threshold, the voting rights increase less than proportionally with the capital shares, which is a way to avoid the fact that a media company is captured by one or two powerful shareholders. And below this threshold, for the small stockholders, the investors will receive a proportionate boost in their voting rights, which means that if you are a small journalist, a small employee, a small citizen investing money in a media company, you will have much more voting rights than the one represented by your capital share, so that to equalize the power around the table. Okay. Is that realistic? Yes. If you take a country like France and the US, and in fact, I check Korea in a sense, you only need to introduce a new legal status. This is something I have been fighting for now like 5 years, and things are changing slowly in a number of countries, and I hope they will change even more in the future. But what I want to highlight is that in a number of countries, including my own country, France, I have launched a number of crowdfunding campaigns for media outlets, and every time it has been a huge success. So now citizens are willing to participate in the funding of their media because this is a way to have trust back in the media organization. The second thing is that is the media, is a non-profit media company too complicated? In a sense, no. This is what is done for the New York Times as of today and also for Google, the fact of having different capital shares with different voting rights. Okay? If you take the New York Times, the family that historically was owning the New York Times, as of today, it has each capital share with 10 voting rights, and all the voting rights of the new, all the capital shares of the New York Times that are just listed only have one voting right. So we know very well how to do it. Is that going to give too much power to the government? It's exactly the contrary in a sense, because the other way the government intervenes in the non-profit media organization is through the tax deductions. So if you, as journalists or as citizens, you want to improve the future of your media company by investing money in your media company, the government is going to give kind of a boost. So you give $100, the government is going to give $200. And so this will be a way to promote this model to guarantee the independence of the journalist. Let me just finish by two examples from Korea. I already mentioned in the introduction Ankyore, but I think for Ankyore, for me, it's kind of one of the models I am defending when I go like to the US or to France, to the UK. People are asking me, but is a non-profit media organization feasible? And I just told them, you know, this was not my idea. It was done much before, but it works pretty well. Okay, if you look at this company, as of today, the company has more than 60,000 citizen shareholders. And you have no shareholder with more than 1% share. It includes journalists, students, professors, lawyers. The newspaper very often made small fundraising campaigns, and apparently it works, and it works well, and it works as well as other media companies that are owned in a more traditional way in Korea. And I want also to underline a second example in Korea, which is the one of Kyung Jong Shinmun, an independent newspaper with employee ownership since 1998, and now all the employees, they are the biggest shareholders of the companies, and the CEO and management staff are elected by employees through open recruitment. And it also works pretty well. This is not so far from the non-profit media organization model, and I hope this will generalize not only in Korea, but I see that as the future of the news media in Korea, but also elsewhere in the world. I want to say that the first time I decided to work on Korean media, like people told me, you will see that Korean media organizations, they tend to be owned by very huge companies with a lot of concentration in the sector. So I was not expecting to use Korea as an example of what should be done in the media industry. And in fact, I realized, in particular through these two groups, that Korea should be used as an example of what should be done in the media industry. And I think, and I hope, we will find other companies following the same track in the future. So let me just finish by saying that something like the non-profit media organization does not solve all issues, but it allows more democratic power sharing. It also gives a new place for societies of readers and employees. Before, we were talking about the fact that now, in a lot of countries, including France, we have more and more employees in the board of companies. This should not be done only for the media, but I think we need to begin with the media, because for the media, it's particularly important to have a democratic reappropriation of the production of information by those who consume information, the citizens, by those who produce information, the journalists, rather than by all those billionaires that have enough money and power to shape public opinion and to use their money just to buy the media companies they want to buy. Okay, so I think that this is also a way to increase the trust back in the media. This will be necessary in the battle for reputation, in particular in today's world of fake news. We talked before about economic democracy. I think we should fight for economic democracy. We should also fight for political democracy and to save political democracy, in particular against the rise of populism everywhere in the world, one needs first to democratize the media. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so very much for your intuitive talk and the amazing food for thought, Professor. 카세이. 네, 정말 수고해 주신 줄리아 카세이 교수님 입문 특강 들었습니다. 피케티 교수님의 부인이시기도 한 카세이 교수님의 특강이었는데요. 다시 한번 큰 박수 부탁드립니다.